Welcome to this episode of Peaks. Today we will discuss about the applications of chemistry in our day-to-day life. Now, you can easily understand that various chemicals play a very important role in our day-to-day life. For example, can you visualize a world without iron or aluminium? These metals are so widely used. Similarly, another chemical which finds a lot of application is cement. Like that, one can come across a wide variety of chemicals which are applicable in various fields. For example, a number of chemicals find application in the field of medicine, agriculture, textiles, etc. So, we will concentrate our attention only in certain aspects as far as the application of chemistry is concerned, mainly to drugs, food and cleansing agents. So, first of all, we will have a broad discussion regarding the various drugs and their classification. Today's session we are including drugs and their classification, drug target interaction, therapeutic action of drugs, chemicals in food and cleansing agent. So, we will start with drugs and their classification. Drugs are chemicals of low molecular masses. When the biological response of these chemicals is therapeutic, they are called medicines. Use of chemicals for diagnosis, prevention and treatment of diseases is called chemotherapy. So, you know that a large number of medicines are used for treatment of various kinds of diseases, and please do remember that these medicines can be used only under the prescription of a medical practitioner. And also, you should remember that in the case of a number of medicines, excessive use should be avoided because many of them are poisonous also. Now, the molecular masses of these drugs will range from 100 to 150 roughly. Now, how can we classify the drugs? Drugs can be classified as follows on the basis of pharmacological effect. Well, for example, you consider the common headache. When you go to a medical shop and ask for some tablets for curing the headache, they will give you some tablets. Well, the composition of the of these particular medicine may be slightly different, but the main function will be the same, that is curing of headache. So, the pharmacological effect is the same. In as far as this type of classification is concerned, this is very useful for a medical practitioner because they are presented with a variety of medicines which can cure a particular problem. Then, secondly, on the basis of drug action, this is also quite important. We can illustrate it with an example. Histamines. Now, one of the functions of histamine is to liberate hydrochloric acid in the stomach. We will return to this point a bit later when we discuss antihistamines. So, antihistamines, the function is to control the action of histamine because acidity is a common disease. And that is due to the presence of histamine or the action of histamine. So, this action has to be controlled. A number of medicines are used to control the activity of histamine so that the acidity can be decreased. We will discuss about those mechanisms a bit later. So, all types of medicines which are antihistamines are classified together. Such medicines are called antihistamines. And then on the basis of chemical structure, a number of medicines having the same structure or similar structure can have the same kind of biological action. See, for example, consider this structure. Now, this linkage is known as the sulfonamide linkage. So, a number of sulfur drugs will have this structure. So, the biological action of these medicines or these drugs will be similar or same. Then, on the basis of molecular targets. So, these molecular targets are, well, they can be carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, etc. A particular drug may act on any one of these molecular targets. How do they function? Let us see. Macromolecules of biological origin perform various functions in the body. For example, proteins which act as biological catalysts are known as enzymes. Proteins which are crucial to communication system in the body are called receptors. Nucleic acids have coded genetic information for the cell. Lipids and carbohydrates are structural parts of cell membrane. So, any of these substances, namely proteins, carbohydrates, nucleic acids, can be the target. Suppose there is a problem with a particular protein, a drug has to be administered and then the drug will act upon the protein. Then protein is the target. Well, the drug target interaction can be of any type. It all depends upon the nature of the drug and the nature of the target. Now, let us consider or let us explain this with an example. As an illustration for the drug target interaction, consider the catalytic activity of enzymes. Now, you know that enzymes are biological catalysts. A large number of biological processes in our body are carried out in the presence of an appropriate enzyme. Now, in this catalytic activity, enzymes perform two major functions. So, in order to understand how the drug attacks the target or how the drug target interaction occurs, let us consider this example of enzyme action. Now, there are two major functions. Active sites of enzymes hold the substrate molecule in such a way that it can be attacked by the reagent effectively. Now, here the reagent happens to be the drug. Well, for example, let us consider a protein as the this target. Generally, the target we refer to as the substrate. The drug is acting on the substrate. This action is catalyzed by certain enzymes. The function of the enzyme is to hold the substrate in such a way that the drug is appropriately acting on it. For that, first of all, the enzyme will get attached to substrate. See here, the binding between the substrate and the active site of enzyme can be through ionic bonding, hydrogen bonding, van der Waals interaction or dipole-dipole interaction. So, what happens here? The enzyme gets attached to the substrate. There will be active sites on the enzymes, so that these active sites get attached to the appropriate positions in the substrate, so that the substrate is now properly oriented, so that the drug can act upon it. That is the first step. Now, what kind of forces are there? The forces can be hydrogen bonding, van der Waals interaction or dipole-dipole interaction. Now, the substrate is ready. You might have studied about this lock and key mechanism as far as the function of enzyme is considered. You know that for a particular lock, only a particular key will be suitable. Similarly, an enzyme can catalyze only a particular reaction. That means, a particular enzyme will be attached to the substrate in a definite fashion. Another enzyme cannot be used for that. So, just like a lock and key mechanism, that is just like a key getting fit into a particular lock, a particular enzyme can act upon only a particular substrate. Now, the second function of the enzyme is to provide functional groups that will attack the substrate and carry out the chemical reaction. That is the second function. Now, how do the drugs inhibit the activities of enzymes? In certain cases, the enzymes may be controlled. They are called such drugs which inhibit the functions or activities of the enzymes are called enzyme inhibitors. Drugs inhibit the attachment of substrate on the active sites of enzymes in two different ways. Just now we have seen that the first step as far as the action is concerned is attachment of the enzyme on the substrate. So, when a drug is acting on a system, this attachment should not occur. So, competitive inhibitors can be used. These inhibitors compete with natural substrate for their attachment on the active site of enzyme. So, for example, suppose a drug, I am representing it as A, our substrate is S. Both will have appropriate sites which can interact with E, that is the enzyme. Now, there is a competition between the substrate and active site to get attached to the enzyme. If the drug is more powerful, that will get attached to the enzyme through the active sites, so that the substrate cannot get attached to the enzyme. That means the enzyme activity is inhibited. So, there is a competition between the drug and substrate, that is why it is called competitive inhibitors. Then some drugs bind to different site of the enzyme, which is called allosteric site. What happens here? Suppose this is an enzyme which I am representing, this is an enzyme and this is the active site, so that the active site has to get attached to the substrate. The drug may act upon some other position on the enzyme, so that this position is getting attached and there is some kind of distortion occurs in the active site. When there is a distortion in the active site, the substrate cannot get attached to it. Again, consider the lock and key. Suppose the tip of the key is slightly damaged, it won't get into the lock. Just like that, as a result of drug acting upon the enzyme on some other site, which is called the allosteric site, this active site will be slightly dislocated or some kind of orientation change will be there, so that the substrate cannot act upon it. This kind of binding changes the shape of active site, so that the substrate cannot recognize it. So, in either way, the enzyme is inhibited. So, in both cases, the enzyme substrate interaction is nullified. Now, let us consider the receptors as drug targets. Receptors are proteins which are crucial to body communication process. They are embedded in the cell membrane. In the body, message between two neurons and that between neurons to muscles is communicated through certain chemicals. These chemicals, they are known as chemical messengers. Now, what happens here? Now, the receptors are proteins. One can represent a particular receptor like this one. This is a rough diagram. This is embedded in the cell membrane. This is embedded in such a way that it is on the surface, it is exposed. The active site is exposed on the surface of the membrane. Now, the chemical messengers approach this active site and communicate the information to the cell. The messenger will not enter into the protein. Only on the active site it will approach. The messenger will approach the active site or on the surface of the receptor and communicate the information. Then the chemical messenger leaves. Now, suppose we want to inhibit this, what can be done? There are large number of different receptors in the body. They show selectivity for one chemical messenger over the other because their binding sites have different shape, structure and composition. Here also, as in the case of substrate enzyme interaction, it is highly selective. A particular receptor can accept only a particular chemical messenger. So, the job of the chemical messenger is to give the information through the active site here. Drugs that bind to the receptor site and inhibit its natural function are called antagonists. See, suppose a drug is acting upon it, the receptor, and instead of the chemical messenger, the drug is getting attached to this active site, receptor site. Then the chemical messenger cannot approach it, so that communication path is blocked. Now, there are other types of drugs which mimic the natural messenger. See, those which mimic the natural messenger are called agonists. So, under what condition such a kind of drug will be used? Suppose the body has, there is a deficiency in the natural chemical messenger. In that case, a drug which can act as a chemical messenger can be used. So, these are the two mechanisms by which the receptor target, receptors can act as target. Now, let us come to the therapeutic action of drugs. We will consider some examples. First of all, we will discuss about antacids. Well, until the second half of the 20th century, only treatment for acidity was administration of antacids such as sodium hydrogen carbonate or a mixture of aluminium and magnesium hydroxide. These treatments control the symptoms and not the cause. Well, acidity is a very, very common problem. A large number of people are affected by this acidity, and there can be any number of reasons for acidity. Well, till the second half of the 20th century, sodium hydrogen carbonate or sodium bicarbonate has been used, that is this compound NaHCO3. Now, this substance is alkaline. One problem with this sodium hydrogen carbonate is when consumed in excess, the pH in the stomach will increase. This will lead to a greater or more effective secretion of hydrochloric acid. So, in fact, we are increasing the acidity eventually. That is a drawback with this problem. Aluminium hydroxide and magnesium hydroxide is a better drug for acidity. But unfortunately, these treatments only control the symptoms and not the cause. Well, usually this is a common problem encountered in many situations. Suppose you are affected with, say, a fever. One or two days you may ignore it, then take some tablets like aspirin or paracetamol, etc. Suppose the fever is not cured, then only you will think about what is the cause of it. Then, so the fever is only a symptom in many cases. Similarly, here also, when acidity is there and sodium hydrogen carbonate or hydroxide of aluminium and magnesium are used, you are not solving the actual problem, only the symptom is problem. Later, it was found out that histamine is responsible for producing acidity. The chemical which stimulates the secretion of pepsin and hydrochloric acid in stomach is histamine. So, when this histamine approaches the active sites on the walls of stomach, acid will be secreted. So, by some means, if you can prevent histamine from getting attached to the active sites on the cells on the surface of the stomach wall, well, the acidity can be decreased. So, drugs were introduced which are called antihistamine. they control the activity of histamine. Well, one common antihistamine is cimetidine. Let us see here. It is a potent vasodilator, that is, it can cause inflammation. This, that is, histamine can cause inflammation, as I mentioned earlier. And it is also responsible for the nasal congestion associated with common cold. In addition to that, it can contract the smooth muscles in bronchi and gut. Histamine contracts the smooth muscles on bronchi and gut, in addition to these things. Well, the drug cimetidine prevents the action of histamine. That was the first drug discovered to counter acidity. And this cimetidine will get attached to the active sites on the stomach walls, so that histamine is prevented from approaching that position, so that acidity or secretion of hydrochloric acid can be controlled. So, this controls the hyperacidity in the stomach. Then other drugs are also available, synthetic drugs like bromphenoramine and terfenadine also act as antihistamine. Now, let us come to another type of drugs, that is, neurologically active drugs. Well, these are also quite common. Tranquilizers, they are used for the treatment of stress, anxiety, depression, excitement, etc. Well, this is something which is very common, which we encounter in our day-to-day life. We can come across, you might have come across a number of people who are very sober, isolated, do not communicate, very reserved. Well, stress and excitement are quite common. Even a cricket match can provide a lot of excitement, and eventually it can produce some depression also when India loses a cricket match, is it not? Now, anxiety is another problem. Many people are worried about many things, but most of these situations like anxiety, depression, excitement, etc. are only transient. Once the cause is removed, we are free from that. But in many cases, the depression or anxiety will be prolonged. That is a dangerous situation. When the depression is prolonged, it can lead to nervous disorders. Then we come across abnormality. We know that a number of people behave in an abnormal fashion. It can be temporary or permanent. When it is a permanent feature, well, that requires treatment. Well, here some medicines are used. Iproniazid and phenelzine are two antidepressant drugs. Then other antidepressant drugs are also there, like chlordiazepoxide and meprobamate, etc., are mild tranquilizers for relieving tension. In addition to that, derivatives of barbituric acid, namely veronal, amital, nembutal, luminal and seconal are also used. These derivatives are generally known as barbiturates. They are sleep inducing drugs. Tranquilizers are present in sleeping pills. Now, I want to tell my students one thing here. These neurologically active drugs are very, very dangerous. We read about, well, the drug addiction in newspapers, etc. Well, many of these drugs are very dangerous and habit inducing, and all these tranquilizers, etc., especially neurologically active drugs, should be taken only under the prescription of a medical practitioner. So, a word of advice to all the students and everybody who are listening to this, never take any drug. That is the worst thing you can do. Now, let us come to another aspect, analgesics. There are two types, non-narcotic analgesics. Well, analgesics are pain relieving. All of you are familiar with aspirin and paracetamol. Aspirin and paracetamol are examples. They are effective in relieving skeletal pain. They can act as antipyretic and prevent platelet coagulation. Aspirin has anti-blood clotting action and hence used in prevention of heart attacks. So these aspirin and paracetamol are extremely common and most widely used. So whenever we are affected with fever or some kind of skeletal pain, even without a prescription of a doctor, we buy some aspirin or paracetamol and take it. Here also, as I mentioned earlier, when you are affected with a fever or any kind of muscular pain, of course there is no harm in taking aspirin or paracetamol, but even after 2 or 3 days, if the pain or fever persists, never continue that. Consult a doctor. It is only a symptom. The actual problem may be different. Well, and in addition to that, one more thing you can do. That is, there is a habit among many people, even if there is a small kind of disease like common cold, immediately they will go to a doctor. That need not be done. You wait for some time, take rest. Rest is one of the best medicines. If you take rest for 1 or 2 days, well, most of the simple problems like common fever or cold will be reduced. Only then you take to medicines. Then analgesics can be of other types also. That is narcotic analgesics. They are very dangerous. Morphine, heroin, and codeine are examples. Well, heroin is a drug which can be used only under the prescription of a recognized medical practitioner. They are used for relief of post-operative pain, cardiac pain, and in childbirth. Well, it is also used in terminal cancer cases. That means, well, there are a number of patients who are definite to die. The cancer is in the extreme condition. It is only a question of time before they die. It is a very, very painful end. In such cases, narcotic analgesics like morphine or heroin are given to them so that the pain can be reduced. Now, this morphine narcotics are opiates. It is produced from opium poppy. Well, in excess, they produce coma, convulsions, and eventually death. That is why we call it very dangerous. As I mentioned earlier, never take to the habit of drugs because many of them contain this heroin, morphine, etc. Now, let us come to antimicrobials. An antimicrobial tends to destroy or prevent development or inhibit the pathogenic action of microbes such as bacteria, fungi, virus, or other parasites selectively. Antibiotics, antiseptics, and disinfectants are antimicrobial drugs. Well, one of the earliest antibiotic or antimicrobial in general developed was Salvarsan. Salvarsan. This is a drug used for treatment of syphilis. Let us go into some details of that. Paul Ehrlich developed the medicine Salvarsan, which was found to be effective for the treatment of syphilis. Now, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Medicine in the year 1908 for this discovery. he did a lot of work in that field to develop an antimicrobial which can kill or destroy the bacteria responsible for syphilis. At the same time, the drug should not affect the human body, or the toxic effect on the human body should be limited. So, by a series of research, he arrived at this compound, salvarsan. But this compound contained arsenic, salvarsan. Now, the formula or the structure of this compound is this is all. Now, we are interested in this part. Well, as you know, arsenic is a poisonous material. So, salvarsan, even though it is a drug for syphilis, contains arsenic, which is a toxic material, so that the human body will be affected by it. So, Paul Ehrlich continued his research in this field, and at that time he was doing some work in azo dyes also. Azo dyes. These azo dyes contain the linkage N double bond N. You can see a similarity between AS double bond AS and N double bond N. He also found that these dyes can change or induce some color in certain cells. So, he continued his research in that field to find out a drug similar to salvarsan, at the same time not toxic or not poisonous, since there is no arsenic in it. In 1932, he succeeded in preparing the first effective antibacterial agent, prontosil. This prontosil is also a complex molecule like this one, containing this azo group. So, there is a structural similarity between prontosil and salvarsan. He also found that this prontosil is quite effective for treatment of syphilis. In the body, it is converted to sulfanilamide, which is the active compound. So, prontosil, when administered, is converted into sulfanilamide, which is responsible for curing this syphilis. Naturally, this observation led to the discovery of sulfur drugs. Now, a variety of sulfur drugs are available for this treatment, like sulfapyridine, etc. Now, the real breakthrough in antibacterial therapy happened with the discovery of penicillin by Alexander Fleming. Antibiotics have either cidal, that is killing effect, or static, that is inhibitory effect on microbes. That means some antibiotics will kill the microbes, while some other inhibit their activity. Well, some common examples are there, you should be familiar with them. Well, penicillin, aminoglycosides, ofloxacin, they are bactericidal, and erythromycin, tetracycline, chloramphenicol, etc., they are static. That means they inhibit the microbes. All these antibiotics should be quite familiar to you. This chloramphenicol has several advantages. It is a broad spectrum antibiotic. Well, these antibiotics can be classified into different types. Well, broad spectrum, narrow spectrum, etc. Name itself indicates that a broad spectrum antibiotic can be used to control a wide variety of microbes. A narrow spectrum has only limited range. For example, penicillin is a narrow spectrum antibiotic. Well, one aspect is also important. Before treating the patient with penicillin, a test for allergy must be carried out, because many patients develop allergy when injected with penicillin. Chloramphenicol is a broad-spectrum antibiotic that can be used against typhoid, dysentery, acute fever, meningitis, pneumonia, etc. Antiseptic and disinfectants. Antiseptics are applied to living tissues such as wounds, cuts, diseased skin surface, etc. Some important antiseptics are furosemide, sulfuromycin, Dettol, tincture of iodine and iodoform. Among these, from your examination point of view, Dettol is quite important. Usually a question is asked. In a number of question papers, I have seen that question. What is the composition of Dettol? A mixture of chlorosilanol and terpinol. And tincture of iodine is also quite important from your examination point of view. They are important antiseptics. Then disinfectants are applied to inanimate objects such as floors, drainage system, etc. You know that floor cleaning liquids, they contain phenol. You might have encountered that peculiar smell that is due to the phenol present in it. Now, before we go into this chemicals in food, a word about anti-fertility drugs. This is quite important because one of the features worldwide is increase in population. Quality drugs have increased the health of people, so that even an age of 60 years is considered as very common nowadays. So, the lifespan has increased. Main reason, well, a lot of advancement in medical field, that is one of the reasons. And people are more conscious about health conditions, environment, etc. So, naturally population increase has their own side effects also. Well, shortage of food, environmental pollution, etc. are some other consequences of increase in population. Therefore, it has to be controlled, birth control or family planning. So, anti-fertility drugs are used in this sphere. Now, you know that many of these drugs are derivatives of estrogen and progesterone. So, anti-fertility drugs are derivatives of synthetic derivatives estrogen and progesterone. This progesterone can control ovulation. So, one common drug used in this field is norethindrone. This is a widely used anti-fertility drug. Now, let us go to chemicals in food. Main categories of food additives are colors, flavors, sweeteners, emulsifiers, stabilizing agent, antioxidants, preservatives, nutritional supplements such as minerals, vitamins, etc. Now, we will confine our attention to some artificial sweetening agents. These are quite important, especially for diabetic patients. Let us see. Aspartame, saccharin, sucralose are some common sweeteners used. They substitute glucose and sucrose, which are natural carbohydrates. The sweetness value of them in comparison with cane sugar are 100, 500 and 600 respectively. That means aspartame is 100 times sweeter than sucrose, ordinary sucrose. Saccharin is 500 times sweeter than sucrose, and sucralose is the sweetest among them. the sweetness value is 600 times that of ordinary sucrose. In addition to that, some common food preservatives are also used. They are table salt, sugar, vegetable oils, sodium benzoate, etc. You may be familiar with these preservatives added to pickles, etc., so that the pickles can be kept for a long duration of time. Now, coming to the cleansing agents, soaps and detergents are the common cleansing agent. Soaps are sodium or potassium salt of long chain fatty acids like stearic, oleic and palmitic acids. Soaps containing sodium salts are formed by hydrolysis of glycerol ester of fatty acid with sodium hydroxide solution. This reaction is known as saponification. Generally, potassium soaps are soft to the skin. So, let us see the reaction here. The long chain fatty acids, let us consider stearic acid. Stearic acid is C17H35COOH. Now, the glyceryl ester of stearic acid is the glyceryl ester of stearic acid. Instead of stearic acid, palmitic acid or oleic acid can also be used. This is boiled with sodium hydroxide solution, so that we get the sodium salt of the acid. So, as a result, we get three molecules of sodium stearate, and the other product is glycerol. So, this sodium stearate is the soap. Hydrolysis, base hydrolysis of the ester. This is the ester which is hydrolyzed with a base, and the product we get is the sodium salt which is the soap. All forms of soaps which we encounter in the market will be sodium salts of such acids. And the reaction is known as saponification, that means soap is produced. As I mentioned earlier, the other product is glycerol. So, glycerol can be recovered after removal of the soap. Instead of sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide can also be used. In that case, you get the potassium salt. Potassium salts, as mentioned here, generally potassium soaps are soft to the skin. So, the baby soaps, they contain this potassium soaps. Then the various flavoring materials can also be added to the soaps. Toilet soaps are prepared from better grade fats and oils. Transparent soaps are made by dissolving soap in ethanol and then evaporating the excess solvent. Shaving soaps contain glycerol to prevent rapid drying. Laundry soaps contain fillers like sodium rosinate, sodium silicate, borax and sodium carbonate. So, you can see that depending upon the purpose, the composition of the soap is different. Then soap powders and scouring soaps contain some soap, a scouring agent that is finely divided sand and builders like sodium carbonate and trisodium phosphate. Then, synthetic detergents. Just like soaps, detergents also play a very important role in our day-to-day life. Well, the advantage of a detergent is that they can be used both in soft and hard water. You might have studied in your class 11 course that ordinary soap will not give a ready lather with hard water. So, soaps cannot be used with hard water. The reason is that, as I mentioned just now, soap is the sodium salt. Hard water contains magnesium and calcium salts. So, when soap reacts with hard water, the sodium will be replaced by magnesium or calcium. That means you are getting not sodium soap, but magnesium or calcium soap, which will be precipitated, which will appear as a gum, so that all the cloths will have a dull appearance. The gum will stick to the cloth. That is why hard water is not suitable for washing with ordinary soap. But detergents, they are not affected by this one, because detergents do not contain such sodium salts of fatty acids. So the advantage is they can be used both in soft and hard water. Anionic detergents are sodium salts of sulfonated long chain alcohols or hydrocarbons. The anionic part of the molecule is involved in the cleaning action. Sodium salts of alkyl benzene sulfonates are an important class of anionic detergent. Cationic detergents are quaternary ammonium salts of amines with acetates, chlorides or bromides as anions. Cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide is an example. Well, generally these cationic detergents are more expensive than anionic detergents. So the commonly used detergent is the anionic detergent. Then in addition to that, non-ionic detergents are also there. Well, liquid dishwashing detergents, which we are using in our household, a number of chemicals are used for washing the vessels, dishes, etc. in liquid form or in solid form, they are non-ionic type. Then finally, detergents having unbranched hydrocarbon chain can be biodegraded more easily, and hence pollution can be prevented. So pollution is a great problem as far as detergents and soaps are concerned. When you wash something, wastewater goes out into the environment. Well, collectively one can visualize a situation. Well, this washing is such a common phenomena. Washing can be done or will be done not only in various houses, but in industrial establishment also, where all these washings go into rivers, ponds, etc. They contain a lot of detergents, etc. Now, if the detergent contains branched chain hydrocarbon, earlier we have seen that the first sentence, let us go to that. Anionic detergents are sodium salts of sulfonated long chain alcohols or hydrocarbons. The hydrocarbons can be having a long straight chain or branched chain. If it is a branched chain hydrocarbon, they will not be biodegraded. Just like the plastics, they will remain like that, causing a lot of environmental problem. Well, you are familiar with the problem with plastics. They are not biodegradable. A plastic material will remain as such for even 20 years. Like that, such detergents containing branched chain hydrocarbons are not biodegradable. So nowadays, unbranched, that is straight chain carbon chain detergents, are more commonly produced and used, so that the pollution effect can be reduced. So in spite of all these precautions, there will be pollution, but what we can do is we can only control them. Now let us consider some questions and their answers. First question: receptors which are crucial to body's communication process are carbohydrates, vitamins, enzymes, proteins and hydrocarbons. Well, the answer is given in block letters, so the answer is proteins. Well, in this chapter, all these questions and their answers are memory based. Second question: an example for antihistamine is, well, bromphenramine, aspirin, veronal, luminal or floxacin. Aspirin is a antipyretic, veronal and luminal are barbiturates. They are sleep inducing tranquilizers, that is CND. Ofloxacin is a antibiotic. So the answer is A. Then three: neurologically active substance is erythromycin, prontosil, alitame, furosemide. Well, erythromycin is an antibiotic. Prontosil, we have already seen that prontosil is a substitute for salvarsan in the treatment of syphilis. Alitame is an artificial sweetener. Furanicin is an antimicrobial. And morphine is our correct answer. Then four, the sweetest among the following, sucralose, that is 600 times sweeter than ordinary sugar. Then, in the catalytic action of enzyme, the binding between the substrate and active site of enzyme cannot be through. I mentioned earlier that the binding can be through ionic bonding, van der Waals forces, hydrogen bonding or dipole-dipole interaction. It will not be through strong covalent bond. What will happen if there is a covalent bond is formed between the substrate and active site? The bond is so strong that the enzyme will not be released. In any catalytic activity, the catalyst will be recovered. So, in the enzyme action also, once its action is over, the enzyme should be relieved from that site. If it is a strong covalent bond, it will remain as such, and that enzyme activity will be permanently terminated. Then, select the wrong statement. Noradrenaline is a neurotransmitter, that is correct. Barbiturates are hypnotic. Then, penicillin G is a broad spectrum antibiotic, that is not correct, it is a narrow spectrum antibiotic. Histamine is a potent vasodilator. We have already seen that it causes inflammation. Iodoform can be used as an antiseptic, that is also correct. 7. Soaps used for cleaning purpose are sodium or potassium salts of, well, just now we have seen that it is stearic and palmitic acid. The other options are not correct. Benzoic acid, formic acid, acetic acid, etc. are not used. Then, sulfur drugs are derivatives of benzene sulfonic acid, sulfapyridine, sulfanilamide, then para-aminobenzoic acid, benzoic, acetic and formic acid. The answer is sulfanilamide. 9. Aspirin is an acetylation product of, the correct answer is orthohydroxybenzoic acid, that is this is orthohydroxybenzoic acid. As a result of acetylation occurs at the OH group, this product is formed. This is aspirin. Which of the following is not an artificial sweetener? Sucralose, allitame, saccharin and aspartame, they are artificial sweeteners. Sucrose is a natural sweetener. The antibiotic used for treatment of tuberculosis is streptomycin, penicillin, etc. The answer is streptomycin. Then, last question, a substance which can act both as an analgesic and antipyretic is quinine, aspirin, penicillin, insulin, cetirizine. The correct answer is aspirin. As you know, it can reduce fever as well as reduce pain. So, we are concluding this session. I hope you got an insight into the various types of drug action, the food materials that are used, and also the importance of cleansing agent also. So, also you should be more conscious about the environmental problem related with these detergents, etc. So, thank you very much. Wish you all the best.